United Church of Christ. We're so glad you've joined us wherever or whenever you are joining us. A couple of announcements to bring before you today. Just a heads up, next week we will celebrate the sacrament of communion. So keep that in mind. We'll have a communion service. Also, another sacrament next week you will get to view with us, the baptism of Henry Harrison Hayes. That is going to be held over the weekend, socially distanced, but the family, and we would like to share that sacrament with you. So make sure you watch us again next week. Today we are trying something that we have not done since the last Sunday of February, and it is Penny Sunday, but it's really going to be Penny Week. So we're going to try this. So all week there will be a bucket in the vestibule of the church during church hours. So between 9 and 3 would be a good time to come just drop off your pennies, dimes, nickels, dollar bills, checks, whatever you've got, and put them in the bucket. And that will be going to St. Herman's House. And you'll hear more about that from Pastor Heidi. Does anyone else have announcements today? Seeing none, we will continue with our worship. We are people who have been called to follow wherever God leads us. Our faith leads us to obedience, even when we have no idea what the future holds. We are called to tell God's story of love and grace to others. Our faith gives us words to share the good news. We come together as the family of God to worship and praise the Lord. Together, we tell the stories of Jesus and God's love. And appropriately, we will sing the hymn, "I Love to Tell the Story."
Thank you.
first reading is from Psalm 105. Give praise to the Lord. Proclaim his name. Make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him. Sing praise to him. Tell all of his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. Remember the wonders he has done, his miracles, and the judgments he pronounced. He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Thank you. Well, good morning. It is good to have you gathering with us, whether it's morning, evening, middle of the night. We are here again, and we are glad that you're joining us. As has become our custom, I'll be lighting the candle to remind us to keep in prayer those who continue to go the extra mile to keep life going. Especially this morning, I invite you to keep first responders in prayer. The police, the firefighters, the EMS. Life is so complicated right now, and every time they go out on call, they are putting themselves at risk that the other person has not been taking precautions. So please keep these people in prayer. Also keep travelers in prayer as life has become more complicated with borders closing both nationally and within our United States. There's so much to pray for. Let us pray. Eternal Almighty God, we give you thanks for this time together and the sure and sacred knowledge that you are here. Wherever we are, you showed up before we even woke up and have been waiting for us to turn and spend time with you. God, as the weeks go on, the concerns and joys of our hearts continue, and we now offer those names and situations to you which are too difficult or too wonderful to speak out loud. You pour out your blessing so freely upon our lives. We pray for awareness. We pray for the gratitude to see your grace at work in our lives and in the lives of those who are dear to us. God, we pray for the courage to speak when we see you at work in the life of another, to praise you and give you thanks for each little thing that happens that we are aware and can say, look, look, there is God in the world, striking out against the darkness, casting a brighter light for all who choose to see. God, we are grateful that you chose to gratify and glorify the human by becoming one of us, by putting on flesh, being born of a young girl, and walking among us, learning as we learn, suffering as we learn, and teaching us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. tough act to follow. Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Mike. That was absolutely beautiful. So, it has been since the last Sunday in February since we were able to collect coins, pennies and nickels and dimes and dollars and whatever else you have stuck in your sofa, for any sort of charity that the Children's Sunday School program could support. So we decided we'd try this out and see how it goes. Somebody already got me started. You know, you've been hearing on the news about the coin shortage. I'm sure it's because you have coins at your house that you've been keeping out of the system, waiting till you can turn them in for Penny Sunday. So who we've decided to support. Last Sunday, Irene talked about a friend of the congregation that takes our Panera Bread to St. Herman's Hospitality House. And so I did a little more looking into them, and I want to tell you a little bit more about St. Herman's. St. Herman, first of all, is a patron saint of children, so that's appropriate for us to collect. But St. Herman's Hospitality House provides, there are three parts to their charitable outreach. The part we're particularly supporting is the part which houses up to 28 homeless men at any one time. And that doesn't just mean giving them a bed to flop on. The place is beautiful. It looks like home. They serve 3 square meals a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And so this is, while it's transitional housing, it's not like come for a night and then go out, you know, as soon as you can, get out of here. It is made to feel comfortable, to help them find a place until they can get their lives back in order. The other two parts of St. Herman's are the housing piece, which provides transitional space for men who are going through a rehab or giving up, getting rid of substance abuse in their lives or something like that. And so they are there for a very short, limited time, but they receive counseling and support there. And then the third piece is a fascinating work in progress. They're developing a farm that has goats and cows and pigs and land to be worked. And so they're developing that to give these same men the opportunity to get out and be able to give back through participating in this farming experience. So, having said all that, now, while you get to go look for all that coin that you've been hoarding and keeping, waiting and waiting, so that you can drop it off at the church next week between 9 and 3, this week between 9 and 3, we're going to show you some of the beautiful faces of the children that we miss. So, take it away, Chuck. Thank you. those little faces. I can't believe how choked up I got. You know, Jesus always had a special place for the little children. He told his disciples, get out of their way, let them come to me. And so the fact that we are able and willing to invite our children not only to be such an integral part of our congregation, but of our ministry as well, as they are leading the way as we collect for St. Herman's House of Hospitality and the many, many other things that we do as a congregation, that all of your contributions support. Penny Sunday is just one small portion of keeping our ministry going, and we are so grateful for your help. So I again would remind you that on our webpage over here, there's a little green box that says Donate Now. You can donate through those prompts if you would like, or you can write a check to Strongsville UCC and drop it off or mail it to 13740 Pearl Road. That's Strongsville, Ohio, 44136. You can bring that by this week between 9 and 3 with your bucket of pennies if you'd like. However you are able to support us, we are so grateful that you find value in what we are doing to promote God's kingdom in this world. Thank you. Let's pray together. Eternal One, may the words of my mouth and the meditations you place in each of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing in your eye, O Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. You know, if there is one lesson we should all be learning during this season of pandemic, it's the lesson about the irrelevance of time as we understand and experience it when placed along the arc of eternity. I have a little ritual that I perform several times a week, and I usually include Chuck in the conversation. I will randomly begin, today is Thursday, July 23rd, 2020. Of course, it doesn't help me that while today is Thursday for us, as we record this service, it's probably not Thursday for you as you watch it. And since I've always gone to church on Sunday, the fact that I'm now doing church on Thursday or occasionally Friday or maybe even Tuesday only serves to mess with my head. Even within a single day, many of us are bereft of routine. We are used to getting up, getting dressed, and going to work. Now, we get up, mostly. Everything else may follow a very different, leisurely pace. Meetings that used to happen face-to-face now become virtual, Zoom events. One day flows into the next, often with tedious monotony. When we look at Scripture, time has a different character. In the original Greek, time in the New Testament takes one of two forms. There's chronos time and there's kairos time. Chronos time refers to clock time, you know, 24 hours in a day, 7 days in a week, and so on. It's the kind of time Shakespeare is writing about when he gives Macbeth these lines. Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to the last syllable of recorded time, and all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. It even kind of sounds like Corona time, doesn't it? Chronos time is the way we keep order in our lives, the way we measure our time on this planet. We are born, we live our lives, we die. Kairos time, on the other hand, is God time. Kairos is viewing time through the lens of eternity. Kairos is the kind of time, for instance, found in the creation story, when we are told that God created everything that is in 7 days. Even though the description sounds like typical days with evenings and mornings, those days are chronos ways of measuring. Creation took exactly as long as it took, and we really have no way of measuring that. Oddly, creation continues today. Kairos time is strangely timeless. In today's passage from Paul's letter to Rome, Paul gives us a God's eye view of things. Paul is writing to the Christians in Rome whom he has never met. He hoped to follow his letter with a face-to-face meeting, but life interrupted his plans. It is a full 3 years before he ever gets to Rome, and then he's a prisoner of the state, not a free man. Nevertheless, this letter is filled with grace and hope and promise, especially in this passage we're looking at today. Now, as you probably know, I really appreciate Eugene Peterson's The Message, but some passages just sound better when we hear them read in a little more biblical language. So listen as I read from Romans 8, the New International Version. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray, but the Spirit herself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to God's purpose. These verses are Paul's brief look backwards through God's perspective. In the verses right before this passage, Paul is teaching about suffering. He is reminding his audience that what the Christian Romans are going through now is awful, but God has never left them. Their status as sons and daughters of the Most High remains unchanged, and when they pray, whether or not they have the words, God is already listening, already at work for the well-being of those who love God, even if it might not feel like it right now, at this time. Have you been there? Have you had that experience of having a heart so full there simply are no words to speak? I know I have regularly. Sometimes my heart feels empty, as though there are no words at all. Other times my heart feels like it's so stuffed up with words, all trying to get out, all stacking up on top of one another, like one of those really awful traffic accidents we see on the news. This, Paul reassures us, is where God's Holy Spirit is already at work. When our hearts ache with agony or with joy, the Spirit takes over. She steps in on our behalf, releases those jumbled up words in silent prayer that reaches straight to the heart of God. Paul is reminding us that even when life seems darkest, God has never left us. God is still at work, bending the long arc of eternity towards love and justice for those whom God calls beloved children. The promises God's children prayed in generations past may be just coming to fruition many years later, but in God's time, in Kairos' time, all things, deadly viruses, lazy leadership, economic struggles, all things will come together for the good of God's kingdom and eternal reign. This, friends, is the promise we participate in as children of God. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Oh, but Paul is just getting warmed up. Like a late night TV huckster, Paul turns as if to leave, takes a deep breath and adds, "But wait, there's more." Listen. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, give us graciously all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God, interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? Paul is really fired up now. He ticks off just about every single thing that could possibly afflict us in life. And here's the deal. The Christians in Rome were under siege, just as we often feel today. They were fearful of being arrested for things they hadn't done by mysterious men claiming to work for the state. They often lacked food or a roof over their heads and counted on the kindness of strangers to provide until the tide would turn again. It was not uncommon for someone to head off on a journey, even a short one, and never return home to their families. Can you imagine? I know you can. The more things change, the more they stay the same. But Paul was an educated man, a trained orator who really knew how to bring it home. He has never met his audience, yet he knows exactly what they need to hear to make it through another day. Listen. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I am guessing you have heard these words before. They're commonly offered as words of comfort to grieving families when they have lost a loved one. When the world is falling apart, we don't want to hear platitudes. When a parent or spouse dies, we don't really care if God just needed another angel. When someone we care about is lying in a hospital bed struggling to draw a breath as machines do their work, it's not necessarily much comfort to hear that God has a plan. Make no mistake, God does have a plan, I have no doubt. But the God who loves us enough to clothe himself in human flesh, suffer and die as a human, has not made a plan that involves pain and death and destruction of our planet. These things happen. They are part of this thing we call life. As long as humanity and creation are broken, as long as we are unwilling to follow Jesus closely in love and caring, these things will continue. Paul acknowledges this. He could have turned and walked away right there, leaving us confused and hurting. Stuff happens, oh well. But that's not what Paul's experience of the living Christ has shown him. Paul personally knows there is nothing in the world that can ever drive a wedge so deep between us and God that God cannot reach across that crevasse and extend God's healing, grace-filled touch. I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, like any good attorney, Paul makes his point, lists as many examples as he thinks is necessary, and then he adds a disclaimer. In case there's something you think I forgot, read the fine print. It's in there too. Nothing, neither riches nor poverty, neither hunger nor plenty, neither violence nor virus nor vitriol, neither being together nor being apart, can separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Those words are today's comfort and tomorrow's promise. So which of those words did you need to hear today? Maybe there is something going on in your life that you're thinking can't possibly be included in those promises. Did you check the fine print? Nothing in all creation. Jesus Christ was present at the moment of creation. God's Holy Spirit hovered above the formless waters at creation. The Almighty God continues to work God's wonder today, thousands and thousands of years later. Paul would never have referred to himself as a Christian, yet he clearly proclaims the message of love he himself experienced on the road to Damascus, the love that changed his whole world. It's been another week, hasn't it? Our hearts are likely full again. I invite you to take a moment right now and just rest in the quiet of your household or wherever you are. Allow the Spirit to speak in your heart, to soothe your tired soul. Remember, as Jacob came to realize that wherever we are, surely the presence and the Spirit of the Lord is in that place. We pray, O Lord, for eyes to see where you are at work, for ears, O Spirit, to listen for your whispers of peace and promise, and hands like yours, O Christ, to reach out in love and grace. Amen. Sing with us, won't you? Be thou my vision.
Thank you.
So there's a challenge. Whatever is going on in your life, try to allow God's vision to be your vision. Wherever you're going, whatever you are going through, look for God. Seek God's face. Seek the heart of the Lord. And as you pray, move your feet and follow where God would lead you. Now may the peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Know that wherever you are, God is with you. Go in peace. Amen.